food, and I think sure as well. So thank you so much for your service as the chair for, what was it, last 2 years? All right.
Ready?
All right, thank you. Speech. Moving on to agenda item 2, approval of the meeting minutes. Comments on the meeting minutes, if not, we'll
move approval.
Second.
Thank you.
All in favor? Aye.
Onto agenda item number 3, financial update.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, thank you again for making time. And as you all know, we do our best to get you financial updates as the information is available. And James is going to give you an update, and hopefully we can answer any questions you may have. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. During the summer, I presented an overview of the FY 2023-24 RTA budget. Today, we'll take a brief look into revenues and expenditures through the first 4 months of the fiscal year. Our excise tax revenues through October are nearly $40.5 million, or 5.3% over the adopted budget projection to date. This amount is a 5.4% increase over the FY23 actuals through the month of October 2022. For expenditures, the roadway element has reimbursed just under $407,000 since July 1. $405,000 of these expenditures belong to the Downtown Links project, followed by a design expense for the Grant Road Union Pacific Railroad underpass. The two projects are sponsored by the City of Tucson. With the anticipated completion of the Links project sometime in calendar 2024, we expect to see a sharp increase in reimbursement requests in the coming months. And transit element expenditures for its Sun Shuttle and special needs services are just under $2.3 million through October. And with that, Mr. Chair, thank you for your time, and that concludes my time.
Thank you, James. So, Mr. Chair, the main reason we want to touch base on the topic is mainly the next item, because that's where the interest is, and everyone wants to know our financial status for completing the remaining projects. So we'll be happy to answer questions now, or during the next item, we can probably dig in a little bit more deeper.
Questions on agenda item number 3? I will move on to agenda item 4.
All right, Rick's gonna give us the presentation on this one. And again, as I mentioned, we've been working proactively to demonstrate that the RTA's financial position is strong, and we're able to complete the remaining projects. The board already acted on deferring 4 projects because they were all scope change proposals. But the balance of the program, we feel confident that we have the financial wherewithal to program those projects and complete those. So with that, Rick, please go ahead and go through the projects. And again, feel free to ask questions. You can hold them for afterwards or during the presentation.
Fantastic. Thank you, Farhad. So as we get into this, Farhad's used the analogy before, and it still carries over, especially prudent now. You've all heard the story about the big rocks, the little rocks, and then the sand. This is the same type of approach on this. The big rocks that we try to put in the jar are federal funding. They're the most restrictive. They're the most limited in what we can do. But when we find projects that are good, suitable opportunities, we want to sure and make sure we maximize that to the greatest extent possible, then plug in the gaps with HERF and then save the RTA as the most flexible source for last. So I want to open up with that because that's not always an intuitively obvious. Sometimes the question comes up of why are we starting with that? That's the one we want to make sure that we're doing the most with because it's got the least ability to move around once we make decisions. So our transportation improvement program subcommittee is working right now as we speak. Meetings are ongoing. We had one earlier this month, and we'll have one penciling in later at the end of the month, come back and follow up on it. And the two biggest challenges that group is working on right now is associated with what I explained. How do we program our surface transportation block grant? Our federal funds, if you will. And right now, I think when we reported in the summertime, we were looking at fiscal years 24, 25, and 26. We've now added 27, 28, and 29 now to the mix so that we're able to use those and look at the out years. And I'll explain how that comes into play in just a second. Part and parcel with that is the insurance that we want to make sure that obligation requirements, mandates, and everything else can be met. When it comes to federal funds, you have to put them on a year you can get to them because they don't roll. We've been able to work some wizardry in the past where we can do some exchanges, some swapping, other techniques that we can stretch them out, but that's part of their limitation on flexibility. So we have to make sure that the projects they go on can hit key dates on that. So that's why that's a two-part effort and why you see that right up front with how we approach it, tackle it, and that's the guiding principles on it.
Can I ask you a question?
Sorry, Ruth.
STBG, when I was a PAG, STBG rolled over. It doesn't roll over anymore?
It looks like it rolled over because of the background work, but it does not roll. So that's a key component, is it takes an awful lot to work out the shifting and not always successfully. So specifically what our priority and hierarchy on the projects are. So we have several projects that right now are lined up, and I'll talk more about this when we do the project update portion, but projects that are construction ready, shovel ready, you've heard that description before, the ones that are pending with advertisement, they're about ready to go. We want to make sure those are fully loaded. We want to make sure that's fully funded and we're all ready on those to take advantage of pricing now and not worry about the inflations or change conditions down the line. Right behind that, we want to make sure that we've got these projects prioritized, as these are the ones that are necessary for ballot compliance. And you can see the list there. The Braz Aviation, Valencia, what we call Valencia Central, which is I-19 to Alvernon, then Valencia East from Kolb to Houghton, 22nd Street on the east end as well, and then Harrison Road. So these are projects of which no activity's been done to date yet other than design, or if it hasn't been initiated, but it doesn't have another phase that it's been able to take credit for construction compliance on. So these have to meet our period compliance of starting construction before June 30, 2026. So that's the next round of priority. The projects in which a phase has already been initiated, a Grant Road, a Tangerine, a Houghton. On the ballot, it's listed, for instance, as Houghton from I-10 all the way up to Tanque Verde, but through its delivery sequencing, identified several phases that can be built over the course of time. So we met ballot compliance when the first phase was built. Now all the rest of those have greater flexibility because we've ensured that we're compliant with all the enabling legislation. So those type of projects can then be stretched out into the 26, 27, 28 timeframes that I mentioned earlier. So we have a little bit more flexibility to put them later in line. We're not omitting them. We're just putting them into the back part of the line while these other priority ones for insurance with the legal description, while that gets done. Yes, sir.
So what happens if you don't meet the ballot budget compliance or ballot?
Ballot compliance?
So let me take a stab at that. I'll take a stab at that. So I think the context is important, right? So as part of the legislation, we have the first 5 years of performance review, and then we had another one, then we had the most recent one back in 2019. So ongoing as part of that performance discussion, there's always this kind of a what conditions have resulted that you're not meeting certain requirements, right? So that discussion is ongoing with the state and state officials that ultimately have the oversight. Again, as a reminder, RTA is a state entity. The performance report, the audit goes to the legislators, it goes to the president of the Senate, speaker of the House, and the governor. So that context is important. Obviously, our goal is to make sure that we check all the boxes and we meet all the requirements for that. So going back to your question, our desire is to make sure that we check all those boxes and meet all of our commitments. What happens, especially with only 2.5 years remaining in the RTA plan, we want to make sure that we can demonstrate to the public that we've been able to meet all those requirements for the start of each project. And I think we can do it. So I guess the better question, or the better way to answer your question, is that we think we're going to meet it. So we don't even want to anticipate what happens if we don't meet that requirement. So that's our goal. That's our mission. Got a couple hands going up. Go ahead.
Question. When you talk about fiscal years 27, 28, 29, you're using the local sales tax money that's generated before June 30th of 2026, correct?
It's a combination and a good question. And again, I need to put that in context. If you recall, following the recession, we had lower than anticipated revenues. That lower than anticipated revenue was made up by the regional funds, state and federal dollars, to make up the difference. Recently, within the last 2 years, and we met that. So every single project has met ballot amount. So we met that. It goes back to what happens if you don't meet those obligations. So we met the obligation. And then recently, over the last 2 years, we had cost increases that were significant, 40%, 50% or more. So now we're trying to meet the second challenge, which is increase in cost. So that's where additional federal funds, state funds, and any RTA funds collected can be utilized in 27, 28, 29 to finish those projects. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. And again, the gap in funding, just to put it in perspective, due to the recession, it was roughly $300 million. We made that up with state and federal dollars. And then now, due to cost increases, it's almost another $300 million. Did I say 1,000 before? It was $300 million. $300 million initially due to revenue, now $300 million due to cost increases. So that's a significant increase from the 2.1 that was projected initially for the program.
And are you using the same regional monies to make up that gap?
We are using federal, state, and federal dollars to make up the cost increase gap, yes. I saw another hand, yes.
This might not be the right time for this, but just so to educate me, to talk about the big rocks.
Mm-hmm.
How, when you're putting a plan together for the next 20 years, how do you just hope to get certain rocks, or do they commit to the big rocks, the federal government, 20 years in advance?
So we have the region allocation that Farah talked about was diverted by board and council action. So that's an ongoing allocation that comes to the state and comes to the state, comes to the region every year. So we do get that, and we know that that apportionment is going to be. And then there's also any grant opportunities that may be pursued on top of that.
But you just hope to get certain grants, or do you not include them in the
budget? We include them only when they're secured. So we've been typically for the next plan including those only when they've been obtained. So a couple of projects that are under consideration have received grants from the federal government. It's been awarded. So we're now able to work with that as a degree of certainty. Same thing here. We've got the 22nd Street Bridge, won a grant that's in place. Now we're working on the mechanisms for it, but until that's actually been awarded, we don't include it or count it.
Those funds expire, don't they? At some point in time, the federal grant fund, you only have a certain window to use them.
Yeah, right. So that's our definition of those rocks, that there are more strings attached to them, they're more rigid. So it's better to know how you're going to spend the federal dollars first, then the state dollars, then the RTA tax dollars, which are the most flexible ones.
You can do an awful lot with those, but yeah, you need those federal ones to lock down what you're going to do. And not every project is a good candidate for it. It's a lot of qualifying criteria that make it more attractive than others in terms of complexity or features or items.
So if you get a lot of big rocks and small rocks for a project, then you can move to SAM to other projects, correct?
Correct. Conversely, if you get a lot of big rocks in there and you need to transport it to a different container, that's a lot of work. That goes back to those don't move easily from one project to another. So keeping going with that, our update efforts on this, and I mentioned that this is a work in progress. We're having TIP subcommittee activities and meetings as we speak on this. The ultimate goal is to be prepared to go to the regional council with the adoption of the 2025-2029 TIP, and that's targeted for next May. So right now, we're lining up all the activities with the jurisdictions and the various committees to be able to move forward with that. And as we've reported over the last couple of meetings, the deferred projects, the four that the board has taken action on and identified to be deferred to go back to the voters as part of RTA next for that authorization, we can't put any necessary funding on that. We can program it, we can identify it, but we can't actually act on it until that point in time. So that's how some of those discussions are ongoing. That's the project funding, and unless there are other questions, that's the kind of, I want to say it's short and sweet, but it's a lot of work, a lot of effort from the jurisdictions, as well as a lot of our staff that are deeply involved into it.
Let me add to that four different projects as well. So three of those projects are final phases of projects that have previously started. So we've already met compliance for those three. The fourth one is a project that was in period four. And in our programming exercise, we anticipate to have that under construction before 26 using federal dollars. So that one will meet that requirement as well.
I have several questions. I have the project listing from the TIP subcommittee that James presented was a week or two ago, where you list all the projects, RTA projects that are not complete, that are going to be funded through 2029.
Yep.
So there's still a deficit of $160 million. Where's that coming from?
There's not a deficit.
Yeah, there's a lot of red.
Yeah, that exercise that's being done by the committee is to identify federal dollars, state dollars, and then the balance of it is RTA dollars.
But it's still short.
It's RTA dollars. It's not short.
So the exercise you're seeing, it's midstream. So we're only focusing on one aspect of it until we close it out, then it would move into the black, if that answer helps.
No, it doesn't. I'm seeing all these project costs and the funding allocated to each project, RTA, HERF, STBG, and local funds. And there's still shortages on Grant Road, on First, I think it was First Avenue, has a huge deficit.
The exercise was to identify, as Rick described, identify a home for federal dollars first, then state dollars, then identify how much RTA dollars are needed. The RTA dollars needed 160, and we do have that.
You have that deficit, but it's not allocated to the project.
Not allocated yet, but we do have the revenue.
So, okay, and then the second question, if all of the state and federal money is going to current RTA projects, if RTA Next needs additional funds like RTA 1 did, they're already obligated, it looks like, to RTA 1. Where's the bank for RTA Next if all the funds are already committed?
So, two different ways to respond to that. One is we're only looking at 27, 28, 29. To make up the cost increases with regional funds. So beyond 29, there will be other state and federal dollars as well to utilize. So that's one part of the question. The other part is RTA Next. As part of the development of the plan, the board is considering contingencies and other options to make sure that we plan for future recessions.
Okay, but you won't have, I saw that there's 100 million contingency, but you're not gonna have that in year one. So
the projection that's being used for the revenue is much more conservative.
Okay. Okay. The second thing is, in the news, there's been a lot about the 22nd Street Bridge. What's the status of that project?
Can I ask you to hold that one? Because I can jump into the full project updates and address that then, if that's okay with you.
Okay. Okay.
And do you want, I can go into the full project updates and then come back if you had other follow-up questions?
Go for it.
Okay. Because that may then trigger some of the other questions, if that's okay.
But one other thing I had emailed the chair about, are you going to cover the categoricals?
Briefly, yes.
The financial side?
Not in great detail.
All right, I'll save it till.
I was going to say, see what I cover, and then if it leaves gaps, we can talk more about it.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so Crystal, this would be item number five, next presentation. So this is the project updates. Let's see. So this is similar to what we gave you over the summertime. This is kind of a recap of all the activity, all the efforts, everything that we're tracking along with it. So I'll keep eyes and ears open if you have any questions as we go along rather than saving them up. So tried to break this in and follow a similar format that's been used in past years and what we used over the summer, where we start first with the construction jobs. So I'm going to go through all the roadway element first and then jump into the categoricals as we go. So for the projects in construction, Sunset Road, this has been combined and being done in conjunction with the Big I-10 Gap project that's on Main Line, between Ina and Ruth Roth. ADOT is the lead jurisdiction on doing that widening, and we were able to successfully attach the Sunset project and do them jointly together, which makes sense for economies of scale and for overall benefit. So it's under construction now. Some of the features are being worked on as the mainline activities progress, and then they're going to be starting to get into the different bridge elements, roadway connection pieces. That's later in the overall time frame as they get the mainline progressing further along, but then the overall thing will open up all at the same time. So right now that's targeted for the end of 2025, so still a ways to go on how that overall project is progressing. Downtown Links, I think as I had reported earlier this summer, that the eastern half of that project from basically the vicinity of Stone all the way down to where it connects into Broadway is complete. It's open, it's operating and functioning fine and provides the necessary mobility for that portion of the project. The remaining is under construction with all the necessary structures work, wall work. This is the big one that's going underneath the railroad tracks. So they've already shifted the tracks under the shoe fly. That's going forward and they're targeting to finish construction on that late fall of next year. So they're on the home stretch, if you can believe that.
Where's that hooking yet?
Pardon me?
Where does that hook in?
Down in the vicinity of just west of the old TEP building. Okay. Down towards Main is the official tie-in. And it'll come, it basically terminates at Stone. Broadway Boulevard, they're still remaining on a few activities out there. And those are ongoing. The city's working on that as we speak. Anticipate substantial completion on that before the end of the year is kind of our target on it. To the general residents, citizens, and the businesses out there, it looks, tastes, and feels complete. They do have the six lanes up and running. They've got all the bike ped facilities all connected and integrated. So it's mostly some of the other contractual work that's needed and necessary with some of the utility efforts. So, but that one's moving along, and we expect that to be completed here very shortly. So those are the three that are in construction, segueing now into the next wave that's going to be coming down the pipeline. And so this starts off with Tangerine, what we refer to as phase 2A. So the overall project goes from basically I-10 to Dove Mountain. They've broken that into a 2A and 2B piece, and that's how it'll be delivered. So we track it accordingly. Design and right-of-way activities are fully underway. In fact, I think they're coming up on the 90% or they're at the 90% design milestone with right-of-way acquisition fully going on. Initial grading and site prep activities have been initiated out there. Particularly where the utility relocation efforts need to be started here in the upcoming, I think one of the initial ones is actually going to be underway here this month. And then the springtime is when the big push will come with the overhead electrical work, plus the underground utility. The main production work where you look and see and go, okay, that's roadway related. That activity is going to be happening probably spring-ish, once the utilities reach a suitable state of relocation out there. And then we're expecting about a 2-year-plus duration on that. In parallel with that is going to be the improvements at the I-10 interchange. And that's being handled as a completely separate project effort. Town of Marana is leading on that, working closely with ADOT. And essentially, they'll be making some operational capacity improvements out there to allow the interchange now to operate at a decent functional level commensurate with the roadway widening. Not part of the RTA project, but being done jointly so that it now provides a seam and smooth flow throughout that whole area. Yes, sir.
Rick, could you tell me where phase two ends and begins?
Let's see, 2A, the whole 5-mile stretch or 2A?
2A, where?
The 2A. I think it's called Marana Commerce Loop. There's a big utility corridor that goes in. It's roughly about 2 miles east of the interchange.
Okay, that's what I thought. Because I know the water line, there's an issue underneath.
Yeah.
And that's been delayed. Okay, thank you.
You got it. Next one is Silverbell, project number 5. These are in order of sequence on the ballot, not necessarily a sequence in terms of time frame. So I tried to follow that logic still. Finalizing design activities on that, going through the last of the clearances, review efforts. City's making good progress on that. The first phase of cultural work, which is all the advance, site work and recovery activities, that's all been done. Pima County's Cultural Resources Office has completed all that effort, made all the necessary findings on that. The next phase is during construction when they have to get in there when the road's ripped up and where the construction activities are going to be taking place. Advertisement on this is targeted for early 2024 and then construction sometime in the summer. And the length of time on that is necessary because of the significance of the cultural issues. There's going to be necessary training that's going to have to be conducted for all the workers, the crews out there, and orientation on the protocol. It's going to be required from our cultural group as well as the state historic preservation offices. So a lot of sensitivity out there, and we want to make sure the contractors are aware of all that. We've been mentioning, everybody knows, it's worth repeating, we knew this overlap with the I-10 mainline widening project was going to be taking place. The Ruthroff interchange helped facilitate that because we allow that jog as the north end of I-10. You can separate and move over from one place to the other. So that's long been anticipated and has always been incorporated. Next project up is the, oh, sorry, Ruth.
What part of Silver Bell is deferred?
Everything north from Camino del Cerro to Ina.
So what is that, 2B, 3A? What is that?
It right now does not have a designation on there. I think we had talked informally and called that sometimes phase three. But now it's going to be a standalone project from Del Cerro to Ina. And that is going to be listed as the RTNX as a deferred project.
Okay.
Next one up is the underpass at Grant Road, and this is where we're going to be bringing additional lane in each direction through the area. A lot of ongoing dialogue and discussion with the new casino activities and with the Pascuyaki tribe in there. So the project was actually paused for a short stretch around the 30% milestone to allow those efforts to now overlap and make sure that we can do that integrated effectively as necessary. So that has just restarted our coordination discussion and design efforts on it. And we'll be looking forward to get better timeframes as we move forward on that. And as we coordinate that with the Pascuyaki tribe. Grant Road phases 3 and 4. And this is essentially the eastern section that goes from Palo Verde out to Venice, or basically Palo Verde to Swan. Bids open on this project. It's currently on advertisement. Anticipate to open bids this Friday. Within selection of the contractor, pre-construction partnering activities, probably right before the holidays and then into early new year, with construction activities expected to start in sometime in January. There is the last of the utility relocation efforts associated with Tucson Electric Power in the vicinity of Alvernon, and that's going to be starting after the Thanksgiving holiday. Very short duration, quick burst of underground work, and then it'll be everything ready to go for the main contractor. So this one is coming. We're sharing that information through our public forums as we speak, through mainly the business outreach efforts. Grant Roads 5 and 6. Design activities are approaching the 90% milestone. The consultant and project team has identified that they'll be submitting that for review during the month of December. So we expect to see that coming up. And then we'll be reassessing where we go forward with that and all the ongoing discussions about when the funding opportunities will be available for right away and then moving into the construction phase subsequently after that. 22nd Street, to Ruth's question, this one's got a lot of activities that are currently underway. It is part of the ongoing dialogue and discussion with those TIP efforts and funding activities, as I said. By them winning a raised grant, it essentially federalized the project. So now it's a candidate for big rocks. And so we're working with our team members with the jurisdictions to identify how we can enable that, facilitate that, maximize the use of that here in the region. The pre-construction activities are ongoing on that. They're back and forth. They've already selected a contractor through the construction manager at risk approach, which is qualification based. So they've been working very closely with them to identify efforts, activities, items that can be revised, value engineered, and make sure that we're getting the most effective design out of that or any update products that are more available and are going to help introduce cost savings on that. The construction timeframe and the closure of the bridge, all this stuff is happening in parallel. We're still going through federal clearances. We're working on executing the grant that we got for the agreement on that, plus working on the regional federal funds. All those are happening simultaneously. And we're hoping everything lands at a suitable time, probably targeted for next spring/summer, at which point in time we can finalize all those activities and then we're doing the final federal shift. So a lot of work on that is ongoing, a lot behind the scenes, but the project is still progressing and still progressing very quickly and moving forward. City of Tucson's been conducting specific targeted outreach efforts to make sure that affected citizens, neighborhoods, and those areas have been caught up to speed and are actively engaged. And our business outreach through Britt Dornquist's team has been staying connected with the business community out there. So that's why you hear a lot about 22nd Street. It's at the forefront of everybody's mind and attention. Oh, sorry, Andrew, go ahead.
There was an article in the paper about community concerns regarding the location of the bike lanes. And
yes.
I inferred from that there was going to be a pause as the city relooks at that. That my inference incorrect?
I think Hal is right. I think the city's taking that feedback, looking at it and saying, okay, what within the confines of what we can do, given timeframes, given the work that's been done to date, everything else. So we heard concerns, we heard issues. What can we do with it to address it versus what can we do that, well, wait a sec, that's going to cause a disruption. So balancing that action, and that's why you're saying we'll look into it. And that's following that. I think they committed to a 30-day turnaround to be able to evaluate and determine what could be done and what couldn't be.
And so that is all within the constraints of a spring work of working this through. There's no official pause per se. There is.
Yeah. Pause is a kind of a misleading for all of us. They're not pausing anything. They're still keeping everything going the way it is. Okay. It's just saying, okay, you brought up some questions. We'll look into it. Rather than say no, we'll say, give us a chance and we'll take a look.
Yeah. Pause a big rock.
Yeah. Pause a big rock. And that's exactly, we've had ongoing discussions about that, and everybody that's involved on the project is very cognizant of the timeframes we're operating under and the domino effect that needs to be kept from tipping over.
So can I continue on 22nd Street?
Sure.
Are they widening that?
Yes. So it's a full-blown bridge replacement, but the replacement structure will include six lanes, commensurate with what the ballot called for.
So, but the roadway 22nd Street in addition will be widened to six lanes?
For that segment, yeah. So it ties into the six-lane section that's been built as part of the Keno overpass that was done several years ago, and then ties into the six-lane section that is just to the west of Tucson Boulevard.
Okay, so from I-10, it says from I-10 to Tucson, it will be six lanes.
So the I-10, that's correct. The ballot designation had it from I-10 all the way up to Tucson. The phase, or what we call segment three, which is I-10 to Keno, that's one of the deferred projects that Farhad mentioned. And I believe at this point in time, the city is proposing doing just a four-lane section on that one.
So only the bridge is being constructed now?
Correct. This is the big bridge over the tracks.
Okay.
It will tie into the roadway pieces on either side, but the bridge is the big feature of it.
But the 22nd Street regular, the roadway is being downsized. So it's being deferred for the scope because of the scope change?
Just for that section from I-10 to Keno. So Keno was built six lanes. This one's going to be built six lanes, matching in everything to the east. Then that western portion, they've looked at that and made the determination that four lanes is more appropriate with all the appropriate purposes. And upon hearing that, the board agreed that should be a deferred project for voter consideration.
Okay.
Didn't skip anything, did I? Okay, good. Next one up is Irvington Road from Santa Cruz, east of I-10. This project's actually been included with the Irvington Road interchange project that's currently underway and being led by ADOT. So we're making a contribution in that to ensure that the bike and ped facilities are integrated and built all at the same time. Done it similar with what we did on Ruth Roth, Ina, where you get those opportunities, combine it, take advantage of efficiencies. This is the same boat. Design activities are fully underway and construction is recommended to begin in fiscal year 25. Still ongoing evaluation is all part of that TIP activity that I mentioned before. So it's coming, it's pending, but this one will also meet necessary ballot compliance. Next, I'm sorry.
I've got a question. Back to 22nd Street.
Yep.
Saying that the city felt that a four-lane section was appropriate just east of the freeway. And it's inherent for a lot of people thinking that generally arterials are wider as they approach interstates versus being narrower.
As a general rule of thumb, yes, you can get by with that because the interstate will be your big feeder that will be contributing to that. I think one of the dynamics we've probably seen is that the traffic volumes, Keno operates in that capacity, and a lot of the traffic either accesses or disperses from the Keno area or country. Father Keno's roadway as the north-south connector to that. So that may be a more logical one. We see different traffic patterns, different volumes associated with that. And there's also a different setting and different demographic.
In the PM direction, when you're going westbound, there's quite a backup east of I-10 on 22nd.
There is. And so one of the big things, or two or three of the big things, depending on how you look at it, that will be incorporated within the project scope is the grade separation of the railroad track. So there's the spur line that goes down to Nogales. That's going to be grade separated, plus the enhanced bike and pedestrian facilities. So it's tight. If you've driven through that section, you know it's a very tight roadway with also a lot of access points through driveways, everything else. So there's probably going to be some discussion about a median to help separate those maneuvers a little bit and control some of the access points for the side friction. So that those will be things that the current roadway doesn't have that the future roadway expansion and improvements will benefit from. That answer your questions?
Yes, thank you. Yep.
Before you go, since we're held up on Grant Road, is there a possibility that phase 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 will be constructed at the same time?
No, based on the time frame we've got right now, and we don't want it to. Grant 3, 4. Right now is going to start construction in January. We still have all the necessary utilities and right away we got to do for 5 and 6. So it would not be advantageous to try and combine that into one project. We'd lose too much time.
Okay, so 5 and 6 will probably start after 26 or so?
At least. They probably got a good 2 to 3 years of right-of-way acquisition. Then probably if it's on the same level of magnitude as the other one, maybe a year of utility relocation. Okay. So yeah, unfortunately, that's the nature of the beast, is there will be a little bit of separation in there in terms of time. Our Irvington Road, I talked about Valencia, what we refer to as Valencia East, which is from Kolb to Houghton. And so the last piece out there that's existing 2-3 lane combination. Design activities are essentially complete on that project. Right away and utility is all well underway and nearing completion. We're working on the intergovernmental agreement with the city of Tucson on this one. And the anticipation is to try and advertise that in early 2024 with construction targeted for sometime in spring. Late spring of 2024. So this one's moving forward. It's been fortunate that it's a nice, easy, simple job. And so we've tried our best to keep it that way, make sure that there's no additional complications. Houghton Road, this is what we refer to as segment 7. So you remember at the beginning, I talked about Houghton Road was identified on the ballot as a single project, but for ease of delivery, it was broken into 8 individual pieces. 6 of them have already been built. This is number 7, and this includes the big bridge over the Pantano. This essentially goes from Irvington all the way up to 22nd and continues the widening on that. Design activities have been complete. Right-of-way activities have been ongoing and are coming up on the completion. And now the big utility relocation. And there are major ones out there, primarily with gas and with CenturyLink, or who's Lumen is who they go by now. So not 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, but probably to the tune of 12 to 18 months is what we're looking at. So we'll be working with the project team to identify the most strategic time where that can move forward. So still a little ways to go on this one, but it is forthcoming, and we'll obviously be weighing that out as to see when the most advantageous time. I mentioned this is segment 7. Segment 8 is from essentially Broadway Speedway, that stopgap in between, all the way up to Sanca Verde. That's the next project that has been deferred to RTA next, primarily associated with a scope change. And the scope that's being proposed right now that the board is being or considered and accepted as a revised scope for deference is to continue the 4-lane section up through the speedway intersection, then neck it down to a combination of 2 and 3 lanes all the way up to Tanque Verde. And that will handle all of the necessary traffic, turning volumes, maneuvers, and access that we need to. So segment what we call 8 is going to be a standalone project from, I think it's Speedway to Tanque Verde. Okay, moving into the categoricals, all of 41. So Ruth, to your point, your questions that you were asked you to hold off on. So rather than list them all, and there's probably, I guess, 10, 15 that we watch and track on these. In the categoricals, these are the quick, easy ones down and dirty on them. They're a combination of our greenways, pathways, bikeways, and sidewalks. Design activities for a ton of these are all underway. We've got multi-use pathways. We've got bike lane additions. We've got bike boulevard projects, all of them actively moving forward. Some of them were the primary funding. Others, we've been able to take advantage of grant opportunities and were the match amounts. Right now, based on everything we're seeing, we expect these to be rolling out through the 2024 timeframe. Some of the bike boulevards have had advanced pavement treatments going on through the late fall of 2023. Most of those have been completed, and they're going to be starting to prep for advertisement and moving these out the door over the course of the upcoming year. A lot of it's going to be staggering to make sure they don't overload the contracting community all at one time, plus their own workload with what they've got going on with the other bigger roadway projects. So I know I'm bundling all those into one, but that's for simplicity purposes. I can try to address any specific questions if you've got and which ones may be going off of memory, but that's kind of how we decided to best package it as we were talking how about assembling this. The other major category is the transportation wildlife linkages. So I think I reported over the summertime that we had a fencing project as the companion to the improvements up on Highway 77, Oracle Road, to those big overcross and undercrossings that were built several years ago. That's been completed. Oro Valley finished that up, and that's now in place and operating effectively. The other project that we've got's out on Highway 86, where we're looking at an additional crossing. Over the course of the last 10 years, we had constructed a couple of improved underpasses, or basically enlarged culverts, to accommodate wildlife movement as well as the fencing. We were able to bolt that on to ADOT's projects out there. Now we're having to come along with a standalone project. We ran into a lot of kind of, I guess, challenges, complexities over the course of the time on this. And we've identified that there's an alternate undercrossing. Instead of the proposed two overcrossings, which would have blown the budget apart, we can still go in with what we call a dry land undercrossing. Goes underneath the roadway, but it doesn't go in a drainage way, so we have a lot of flexibility on it. We've met with the representatives of the TO district out there and have also met at their request with individual communities out there most affected and impacted by it. We're having the dialogue on their feedback as we speak. We've sent letters to them requesting their official stance, and they'll be returning that to us here in the upcoming weeks. And then we'll be discussing with the TO what's the best way to move forward with this project. The reason that's so critical is not only being on their property, but the TO is the sponsor of this, even though ADOT is in charge of the delivery because it's on Highway 86. So it's an interesting three-way partnership where RTA is the funding source, TO is the project proponent, ADOT is the delivery mechanism. It's why we've got to all be at the same place, same time, same approach, but that's where we're at right now, is awaiting confirmation that our revised configuration is something that they're going to be happy with and we can move forward and go forward on the implementation. With that, and I apologize if I went too fast, I can take any additional questions, go back on anything, or expand on anything that you wanted to know more about.
So Rick, on the last two elements, talk about in the greenways, you could just think, what percent complete are you ready for dollars remaining for those?
And complete, are you, I'm not sure I understand your question. If you would mind asking again.
So as far as like greenways, pathways, bikeways, all the ways, what percentage complete would you say we are to reaching the ballot requirements?
Oh, since they came out of categoricals, there weren't specific line items out there, but in identifying the regional plan, I'd be guessing if I took a stab at it, and I don't have that number off the top of my head, but I'd say got well over 50, and if all the ones coming in 2024, I'd say that probably put us up around 75% of achieving the RTA's board's commitments on the numbers that we've been looking for.
Maybe another way to phrase that was based on a revenue reduction. We almost looked at a 27% reduction on across the board. So that's the target we're trying to reach, to make sure that we spend 27% of everything that we had anticipated. But obviously that doesn't apply to roadways because you can't just deliver 27% of the roadway. So that's why we're using federal and state dollars to make up the difference there.
I can actually answer your question. I looked at the audit, the 2022 audit, where it gave the expenditures through December 2021, which was for the safety categorical, was $123.8 million. No, that's a total, I'm sorry. It was $121.4 million. Then I went to the November 22nd RTA meeting, the board meeting, and you had estimates for the remaining expenditures in the categoricals through FY26, which was 2.4 million for safety. So that's the total expenditure of 123.8 million, which is 31% less than what's on the ballot. Then for the environment and economic vitality, the total spent through the audit was 66.9 plus 12.8 in the RTA meeting for a total of 79.7 million, which is 31% less than what's on the ballot. So it's 31% less of what was proposed on the ballot.
Now, one thing we've been able to do, and I'm glad you brought that up, and that's a really good point. This is where we've been able to really maximize. So there's other funding sources through the region that we've been able to bring. Call it RTAG, I don't know what it is. Regional Transportation Alternative Grants. So that's a competitive grant process in which that's a federal chunk of money eligible jurisdictions are able to put in for those. And we've been targeting the bike, ped, and greenway type of projects. The RTA can be the match, and it's a tiny contribution, roughly 5.7%. So we can maximize our investment, get an awful lot of product out of that. Conversely, we've been working real closely with the city of Tucson on several of their bike boulevard projects, and the contribution we're making, they're also matching that with their own pavement pres efforts and additional funding sources they're able to bring. So we're not the sole funding partner in a lot of these efforts and been able to make sure our dollars stretch so that the dollar invested actually gets us more product than what just the RTA funds are contributing to it. So thank you for that. Other questions? Overall, it's a lot of activity, it's a lot of progress, and it's a lot coming down the pipeline. We know 2024 is going to be a busy year construction-wise for a lot of folks. So I think I alluded to it this past summer, but now we're seeing certainty on kind of time frames on this. So we expect a lot of work activity is going to be coming out the door. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Rick, going back to the Grant Road and the underpass over the Union Pacific tracks, are they going to have to relocate the UP tracks to build that project? It seems awful tight down there.
Tight's a good word for it. Originally, there was a concept that the, I don't want to call relocating the tracks, but working underneath there, and there was going to be kind of a boring out of a tunneling underneath the abutments that was going to allow and accommodate the bike and pedestrian. And the railroad being top of the food chain kind of said no, and I'm being nice. So as a result, a concept that's been identified and has gotten traction and that we're working with right now is to take the bike and ped facilities, reroute them down to the south and put an overcrossing up over the top of the tracks plus the interstate and then tie into the Santa Cruz River Path system. So we are moving those facilities down to the south and separating them out, but now we can get in the full dimension that we want and ensure that's going to work just as safely and effectively as before.
Thank you.
But we are, yeah, we decided not to touch the tracks, touch the bridge, and I don't know who was happier, UP or us.
UP can be very difficult to work with. I know
you're being about as polite as I think any of us would want to be. Yeah, they are top of the food chain of life. Other questions? With that, Mr. Chair, that concludes all of our presentations. Thank you.
Thank you. Good job.
Sure, you don't want to add an extra closure to that?
Thank you,
everybody.